All right, welcome to the final part of the Black Cauldron Sculpt series. Here we are in Blender, and we're just pulling in the GLTFs that we exported individually from Nomad. So that's just simply a Nomad going to the export the GLB GLTF. And I believe it'll import the GLB GLTF by default in Blender. If not, you might have to go into Edit Preferences and enable an add-on. Just search for GLTF and you should be able to find it if it's not there by default. Can't remember. Here, I like to sort everything into collections. And that's going to be especially useful for the tree. I'm going to have the tree in one collection and then we'll just instance that collection around. That allows us to change up the materials on the tree. And have it propagate to the other ones. I'm going to add a plane on the ground, and I'm going to use one of my favorite add-ons in Blender, Blender Kit. That's a default add-on where there's lots of free great materials and models that you can grab. So here I'm just grabbing kind of a cracked earth shader from Blender Kit, throwing it on there as a base, going into the shader and adjusting the scaling on the texture coordinates. Sometimes when you pull in a shader from Blender Kit, the texture coordinates are small or large, so you have to go in and adjust it in your node network. All right, and here I'm going to start adjusting the individual shaders on each of my models. So I'm going to start here with the vest, and I'm going to go ahead and call this M underscore clothing. I like to start everything with an M to designate material. And then just for the other pieces of clothing, I'm just going to choose that same M clothing. I'm going to do a little bit different one for the leather because the leather has a little bit more shininess. So I pull the roughness down on the leather a little bit. I'm not going to get into too much detail over PBR shading networks. I'm just kind of showing my overall workflow and approach. But you can see, for the most part, I'm going through and any materials that have kind of the same ones, like skin, I apply the skin and then I just choose the M skin on the different objects. One of the things that I really like to do when rendering in cycles is to turn on random walk on our shading type. It gives the subsurface a lot more interesting look, usually adds more of a light highlight around the tight corners. It looks really nice. So I'm gonna do a different material for the hair and for the eyes. I'll have a more metallic shader for the blade that I'll also use for the sword. And a lot of these, I'm just using the vertex color that comes straight from Nomad. No reason to mess with that. I will do something different on the trees. For the brows and eyelashes, I like to do something that's completely rough and has no specularity on it. So it's all just a completely black shader. There are lots of little PBR shader tricks I'm using here and there. One of the things you're seeing here is I use a black and white gradient that I pull from the pointiness node. And what that'll do is that'll also create some kind of darkness around the crevices, and you can mess with that to taste. If you want to see a little bit more detailed way of how I work with the PBR shaders, you can check out my Hairless Kitty Blender video. It goes into a little bit more slower detail. So again, I wasn't crazy about the vertex color I had used on the scary tree. So I'm going to kind of build my own shader tree out of that, just going with the brown. I moved the tree to the middle, so he's in the collection, so that way when I instance the collection, here you see I've instanced the main tree. Again, I can update shaders and stuff like that, and that'll all propagate through just fine. As mentioned before, my other trees video, is the tree was designed to have a really interesting silhouette from all angles, so I can duplicate him around, and it'll look like kind of a different tree in the background, so long as I'm rotating everything appropriately. All right, so I did a soft select and moved the ground back in the background so you don't see that hard edge. I'll probably mess with the sculpting of the background a little bit more. Right here, I'm starting to play with adding a fog. I couldn't quite remember exactly the best way to do this. I was messing with the volume shader in the world network, but I think what ended up working a little bit better that I'll do here in a second is I actually just created a fog volume, a cube, and applied a a fog to that. So here you see me adding that cube. I did away with the volume in the world after giving that a go, and this seems to work a lot better. So here I'm pulling the view distance from the camera data into the fog so it gets more dense as it goes back. If any of this you guys would like to see a little bit more detail on, maybe I can do a separate video. Just let me know in the comments. Here you can see I'm switching to sculpt mode and just giving the ground a little bit more interesting shape, so it's not perfectly flat back there. All right, and here I'm duplicating the instance of the tree. So these are instances. This isn't a copy of the geo. So if I were to modify the geo that's in the main tree group, it would propagate to all the other trees. Here you can see how it really pays off to have a good silhouette on that tree as you turn it around, just as I had mentioned in the scary trees video. I do have cycles turned on here so I can get a really good sense of how that fog looks. I ended up getting a pretty good look in the Eevee mode, which you can just switch into the lighting preview mode, not the rendering mode. That's just Eevee. And I ended up getting a pretty similar matching look there. Although I do like the cycles render a little bit better, so I went with that in the end. I have added a big blue area light on the right. And now I'm adding a nice rim light to the main characters with a bright white. I crank the intensity on my rim light quite a bit. So here I'm just laying in my area lights to best capture the characters, show off the characters. I'm also taking a look at the main Black Cauldron cover art as I do this, because I want to match some of the highlights and shading that's in there. It's a 2D drawing, so it can be a little bit tricky to match things just right in 3D, but things like where the rim light is, you know, they're pretty talented artists that did that drawing, so they have a pretty good working knowledge of light in there too. So it's just a matter of kind of bringing those same concepts that they were using into 3D. And then I'll use separate spotlights or area lights to highlight certain areas that are also emphasized in the drawing. This kind of shows off that face. The black on the tree in the face is similar to the eyebrows and eyelashes, to where I don't have any specularity on it. It's just an unlit shader. And I'll even duplicate these tree instances and bring them to the main foreground and place them around just to get some extra foreground branches in there for some extra interest. You can see just how versatile that one tree ended up being. And the main illustration, it has a lot of, not just blues, but kind of these purple and greens in there. So rather than just have a purple light, I have more of a blue and a red. So that way, where the blue doesn't hit, you'll see the red and vice versa. So you get purple where they both hit and get some really interesting looks there. All right, so look here. This is Embergen, one of my favorite new little tools to play around with. I'm just using a default VDB that spits out of Embergen. Embergen creates real-time smoke and fog, and you can export a VDB sequence and pull that right into Blender. You see, you get this really interesting looking fog. If you pull that in, I can do more detailed tutorial on Embergen if you'd like to see. Embergen is a paid product, so it's not free. I believe there's a 14-day trial. However, for what it does, it's pretty amazing. And if you're doing a lot of smoke or fog simulation, it's well worth the price. Adding a point light, and you can see how that just really stands out in that fog, sticking point lights in a VDB volume. So in addition to using Embergen, I'm also going to do another little trick where I use the curve tool in Blender. So I take the curve tool and I shape that in the shape of a smoke wisp to get that kind of interesting. And then I will take the curve tool settings, and you can bevel it so it's got some thickness to it. And you can play with even kind of the shape of the thickness, so you get a really interesting profile curve. Then you go to the individual curve points and you can scale the curve points in Blender. So you get those interesting, and you can even rotate them around, get some interesting shapes. But what I'm going to do here is I'm going to then convert it to a mesh and then add a volume and then use the mesh to volume modifier, choose the curve mesh, and you can see what it does is it turns that curve mesh into a VDB volume. But it gives you a lot of control because you can then go back into this curve tool and edit the mesh. And here I'm just using just a soft modifier and moving things around. I actually duplicate it. So I'm going to have two. They kind of intertwine. And it gives you a lot of specific control on a sort of smoky wisp. When you render, you want to really crank up the resolution of that VDB. If I were to go in and really get into a lot of depth and detail in each of these steps, this video would be extremely long. So again, this is more of a workflow, but if you're interested in seeing more of a detail, you can either slow it down, pause it, or I could possibly make another video at some point. Getting really close to the final composition here. I think it all looks pretty good. At this point, it's just really dialing it in and just making sure I got everything exactly the way I would like it. Constantly looking back and forth with my with the main cover illustration. And I want to get that as close to possible, as close as I can as possible, but also still have some nice detail. Here I wanted to go in and paint the inner parts of the sleeve. I was trying to get some darkness on the sleeve just using the gradient with the pointiness trick I had mentioned earlier. Just wasn't cutting it, so instead I decided to paint it darker. And even with it darker, I get a little bit of a sheen in there. And so I end up remapping those colors to where it pulls off the specularity with that darkness value. And here I'm going in a Blender kit and I'm grabbing a cloth. I like to have a sphere that's below my scene that I can test materials on. So I throw a cloth material onto a sphere, find one I like, and then I just grab that normal map and I copy it and I paste it into the cloth on the vest. And I have to dial in the mapping a little bit to get it to look just right, but it seems to work really well. One trick I got from another YouTuber known as Southern Shoddy that does some really awesome YouTube tutorials, something I never really known was the sheen value. If you want to have any sort of cloth and fabric, you want to crank up that sheen value, and it gives a little bit of a lightness around the edge or the edges of the geometry that face away from the camera. It's sort of like fabric wood, sort of like a light fuzz on fabric. I'll see if I can't put a link here to Southern Shoddy's recent fabric video in Blender. Incredibly detailed, really awesome techniques. He even goes in and adds some fur and fuzz on the fabric to enhance it, much like I do in the Hairless Kitty Blender video. So if you are really interested in that technique, you can find it over there on Southern Shoddy's YouTube. All right, so I wasn't quite happy with the texture I was getting on the trees, but what I ended up doing is grabbing this same cracked earth shader and throwing it on the trees, and lo and behold, it just worked. It really added that extra detail on the trees. I think I'm mostly just using the normal map from that, but you can see just all that detail that it added in there. And man, I didn't have to mess with the mapping or anything. It just looked great by throwing that normal map on top of the trees. It was more or less a happy accident. I just wanted to try some things to try getting a little more texture in the trees. And you know, I could have spent lots of time getting specific with sculpting that detail, but in the end, normal map like that just really made it work. I wanted to add some point lights inside the green mist to make it glow. So I've done that here. Constantly reassessing my camera angles and some of the choices I've made. I eventually end up getting rid of the white fog and switching to a black, darker fog, I think. The white fog was probably more true to the illustration, but here you can see the final. I did maybe a little bit more dialing in after the last part of the video, but this is essentially it. I hope you guys like this. If you'd like to see more longer series videos, let me know in the comments below. I hope you enjoyed this multi-part series, and I hope you got a lot out of it. It was a lot of fun. It was a sculpt I've been wanting to do for a long time. In the meantime, I will talk to you guys later. Thanks.